Okay, hi. Welcome everyone. My name is John Wendelboe. I am an engineer with Flow Science here in New Mexico. We are the developers of the numerical simulation software called FLOW-3D. Our specialty is free surface, open channel, fully three-dimensional transient flows. Today I will be talking about how we go about mapping hydraulic zones of influence, and we'll be doing this with the backdrop of impending rulemaking from the EPA on Section 316B of the Clean Water Act, which is currently scheduled to be released, as I understand it, on January 14th, 2014. I have four sections in this presentation. We will introduce the problem at hand, then I will show you briefly how FLOW-3D goes about setting up these types of simulations. Then I will look at results in two different design contexts, a diagnostic and a prognostic context. And to begin, what are we trying to do? A bit more context then on the physics and scales we are trying to capture. It's fairly straightforward. Many power plants need water to cool down their reactors. This water will... Forgive me. this water will often be taken out of a natural body of water through what are called cooling water intake structures. In doing so, there is a potential for fish or larva to be entrained into these intakes, and it is precisely this potential that we are interested in quantifying and mapping. We call that the hydraulic zone of influence of the intake structure. Having served this cooling purpose, this water will then typically be released back into the stream, usually a few degrees warmer than the surrounding waters, in which case we are interested in seeing where and to what extent those warm waters are impacting the environment. This is associated with what we call a thermal plume. So, water in, water out, the hydraulic zone of influence is... Let's see, how do I get rid of this? Thank you. So I was saying the hydraulic zone of influence is the map associated with upstream spatial probability of entrainment into the intake structure. The exhaust waters are described via the determination of the thermal plume. To give you a visual snapshot of what I am about to describe. This is a preview of the kind of mapping I will be talking about. There's a river, a fairly complex topography, and set of coves, a power plant, and an inlet and outlet further downstream. So far, so good. Now, there is a legal context to these studies. I mentioned Section 316A and 316B of the Clean Water Act. The full details of these rulings is scheduled to be released January 14th. In the meanwhile, we do have a general guiding principle that we can work with. I'll read it. It's from the EPA website. Section 316B of the Clean Water Act requires that the location, design, construction, and capacity of cooling water intake structures reflect the best technology available for minimizing adverse environmental impact. So in some cases, not all, but in some, one of these available technologies is in fact to use CFD tools like FLOW-3D to study and optimize the hydraulics of the flow in order to minimize the adverse environmental impacts of these intake structures. Now, it's important to understand that the numerical modeling of the hydraulics that surround a power plant upstream and downstream and near the intakes and outlets are just one component of what is otherwise a usually very complex environmental and ecological system. So there are limitations which need to be understood. This said, there is no doubt, in my mind at least, that considerable actionable design and or remediation insights can be gained from these simulations. So FLOW-3D has been validated in the water engineering industry for well over a decade at this point, and can be used both as a prognostic and a diagnostic tool. Okay, so I encourage you to jot down this email. Any questions, please do not hesitate to get in touch with me directly. I work mostly with hydraulics and water and environmental problems, so I should be able to respond to your questions. If you have registered, I will be sending you a link to these slides, which you can download. Okay, so part two, setting up the simulation. And I have the next four slides in here entirely for reference, actually, just because looking at the list of attendees, I realize some of you may not actually know so much about FLOW-3D. So I will skip these over briefly for now, but I'm leaving them in the presentation for future reference. Okay, so moving on. We are used for all sorts of water engineering applications, complex open channel flow studies, municipal flows, coastal modeling, that sort of thing. Okay, so this is the problem we are going to run. There is a river with a complex topography, curves and so on. And there is also a power plant. So if I remove the water, we see the inlet and outlet structures. And if I put the water back in there and add these colored areas on the right, so these are the elementary areas of the map we are going to construct. So this is how we have decided to map our space. In this case, because the river is flowing from right to left, we anticipate that the hydraulic zone of influence will be contained within that mapped region, an assumption subject to verification, of course. And finally, we expect the thermal plume to run somewhere in that area to the left of the exhaust duct. Okay, so some details. The river segment we have today is 2 kilometers long. The river width, about 140 meters. The upstream flow rate, about 1,400 cubic meters per second. And the intake flow rate for the cooling water intake structure is about 80 cubic meters per second, which means that as a whole, about 6% of the flow is recycled through the power plant. This does not mean that 6% of the lava are affected by the CWS. It's more complicated than that. The region upstream, which we divided into 12 regions, A through K, color-coded. And in this study, we've done a few things. We've considered first the upper 5 meters of the water column for all of these regions. And for regions H, we also did a little bit more of a refined analysis in the vertical and divided the map into three segments, 0 to 5 meters depth, 5 to 10 meters depth, and below 10 meters. So we'll be tracking those particles or traces originating from those different depths and see how they get entrained or not into these intake structures. And also for region A, it turns out that region A has a very high impingement rates, entrainment rate, I should say. We'll see that soon. And so as a prognostic exercise, we will compare the effect of two flow diversions and how this affects the entrainment rate. So all that's coming up shortly. And also, you know, just a general point, there are two situations of practical relevance. One is when you know ahead of time of a specific region of interest, will this specific known important area of the water basin be affected by a CWIS structure? That's one question that we can answer using numerical modeling. And there are other situations where really we know very little about the basin and all its ecological details. So in this case, the hydraulic zone of influence, the map, will tell us where we need to focus our efforts in any subsequent field studies. So there's two ways of looking at this. Okay, so just again, the map we will be looking at, regions A through K. Okay, so setting up the problem in Flow-3D is quite straightforward. That's one of the strengths of Flow-3D, is that the implementation and setting up of simulations is a relatively simple process. So we import topography, bathymetry, and 3D CAD of the power plants, and we do this in the universal format that is used to triangulate solids, called the STL format. That is what I've often called the lay of the land. When we then specify the location and volume flow rates of sources and sinks to model the actual action of the intake and exhaust, we then set boundary and initial conditions as best we can. Initial conditions hopefully based on field data, if it's available. And finally, we need to tell Flow-3D what we want to measure and where. We have two options here. We can either use traces. Think of those as letting some colored dye drift downstream to track its behaviors and motions. Or we can release particles, thousands of particles, and watch them drift with the currents, interact with topography, and of course interact with the intakes and exhaust as well. So finally, in order to measure things like concentrations or particle counts around the domain, we can define either flux surfaces, known as baffles in Flow-3D, or we can also define control volumes as well, anywhere we want in the domain. So this is my cue to open Flow-3D, the interface. Let's see what we have. So the topography and the structures here are simply imported. There's a little STL tab here, and you can readily import the topography as an STL file, and you will also, I will zoom in onto the intake structure, you will also import the CAD of the intake structure, the power plants, the exhausts. You may have some other structural components you want to import into the code. This all gets done via a straight STL import. So there is CAD work to be done upstream, but within Flow-3D, you just import what I call the lay of the land. Next, we have some physics that we want to turn on. In this case, we have in Flow-3D, for those who don't know the code yet, you turn physics on and off as needed. So in our case, for instance, yes, we need gravity, obviously. We want some viscosity and turbulence because these are environmental flows, and our default is to use the RNG turbulence model. We may want some scalars, which are used as, in this case, a tracer for zone A, which I will show you later. We've also seeded some particles, looks like 50,000 in this case. We have a density evaluation, which can be turned on and off, and so on and so on. Generally, in hydraulic and water engineering applications, the modules which are relevant are air entrainment, cavitation, sometimes for pipework, or dissolving objects, drift flux. These are useful for environmental applications. Sediment scour, of course, very important. Surface tension for the small scales, and porous media has its own set of applications which are very useful. And also, I should add, the moving and simple deforming object is what we call the general moving objects module. This is a very powerful module which allows you to have moving objects and see how they interact with the fluid. Okay, so that's the physics tab. Fluids, we simply have water in our case. And then the meshing and geometry tab, we have, so as I mentioned, we first import the topography and structures. We then want to create a mesh. And in Flow-3D, meshing is extremely straightforward. We use fixed Cartesian grids, and wherever we need additional refinements, we simply refine the mesh as needed. For instance, I've got some refinements here around the intake structure. So objects float freely in our meshes. That's very different from many other CFT codes, which use fitted meshes, but we don't do that. We fit the geometry to the mesh, so to speak, and that is a huge time saver. So we have our mesh, we have the geometry. Next, we need some boundary conditions, and I'm just going to hide the topography for a second and show you the boundary conditions. Downstream, for instance, P stands for pressure. We have a pressure boundary condition with a fluid elevation. In the case of tides, we can specify the time series of the fluid elevation at the entrance of the domain. That works very well, and it's done routinely, so tides can be nicely captured as boundary conditions. And let's see, upstream, we have a flow rate, in this case, 1400 cubic meters per second. Okay, the side wall boundary conditions are not relevant because in reality we have solid objects. We have the topography. Okay, so that's our setup. We then have what we call baffles, and baffles are places where you can both measure things as a flux surface, or you can also have, you can also generate a tracer from a baffle. So, for instance, the sink baffle will measure things. Well, I called it a sink baffle because it's at the sink here, which is the inlet of the water structure. Anything that goes through this surface here will be measured and counted. On the outlet, I have a source baffle, which will measure things coming out or through the surface, but also I'm generating a tracer. So I will see, I will be able to track the fluid leaving this exhaust. And you can already see this will be important in the context of determining where the thermal plume will how it will evolve. Then I also have a baffle, let's see, downstream, this one, just to be able to measure things as they flow out of the domain, and an upstream one to see what's coming into the domain. So those are powerful measuring devices. We also have sampling volumes, which allow you to count things in a volume as opposed to through a surface. Then finally, we have mass momentum and mass, well, sources and sinks. So in the exhaust hair, in buried inside the intake, I have a source of fluid which is exiting, which is pushing out warm water, and I can define the density and the temperature of this source of fluid. And then inside the intake, embedded in there, I have a sink, which is entraining fluid from the surrounding domain and making it vanish and creating the absorption. So sources and sinks, that's how we deal with the outlet and the inlet fluid dynamics. And let's see, initial conditions are also readily prescribed, both as global conditions, but also as we can define fluid regions. And for each fluid region, we can specify a tracer. And in fact, let's see, for this simulation, if I go to my initial conditions, I have 1, 2, 3, 4, I have 14 fluid regions, which all have their own tracer, so that we can model this all at once and see where things evolve based on that map that I showed you earlier on. Okay, so it's one of the big strengths of Flow-3D is that it's so simple to set up simulations, and that's really all there is to it. There's definitely some homework to be done upstream, so to speak, but you know, once you've prepared your CAD and figured out your topography and get, you know, got your data from the USGS or wherever, from surveys, once you've done that homework, the lay of the land, at that point you're in good shape and you can set up simulations pretty fast. Okay, so I will get back to the slides. And so what do we have? First, a quick note on steady states. This is really just for the modelers in the audience. By looking at the mass average kinetic energy in the flow, you can get a pretty good feel as to when things have settled down. In our case, it looks like this. And so you could call this a first sacrificial run. This needs to be done before tackling the study in earnest. And what happens in Flow-3D, we typically restart new simulations using the final quasi-steady state solution of this inertial run, so as to get rid of the transients associated with approximate initial conditions. All right, so we run our simulations. And let's take a look. Let's see, I have a little animation. And first we can get an idea of what's going on by looking at the, let's see if I can play this, by looking at the general flow patterns. And to do this, we simply release a tracer all the way upstream and take a look at what is going on. So the tracer is released. We see where we see the tracer meander downstream. On the top left here, we can take a look at the tracer flux intake, which, as we would expect, in the limit, finds its place around 80 cubic meters per second. We can look at some streamlines near the inlet. It's reassuring to see that indeed the fluid is being aspirated into the intake. We have an aerial view, and I'll get back to this later, but we can I separated the thermal plume here on the bottom left so that we can see the shape and extent of the exhaust flow from the power station. And I think the first comment is that, well, it's not actually that simple at all. There is indeed a mean flow that seems to meander downstream, but the detail of what is happening in these recirculation regions, there's many of them, around here, every curve basically, that detail is not obvious at all, qualitatively, let alone quantitatively. How much fluid is entrained? What is the extent of the recirculation, etc.? Not completely straightforward. So, the reason we set up a map in the first place was to be able to locally quantify the probability of entrainment. So let's take a look at zone A, for instance, where these particles have been released in the upper layer of the water column, 0 to 5 meters. And let's see what happens. We have tracers and a particle being released. You see that some of the particles are being ejected downstream. Some are being recirculated in this current. And then we can see the influence of the exhaust air pushing out some of these particles, but only some of them, downstream. So this is pretty informative in and of its own right. It's coincidental that the the release of these particles actually is a pretty much a bullseye towards the intake structure. But we would like to know more. So especially pictures are good for qualitative assessments, but we need to know some hard facts. So what we can do then, we have these baffle windows and volume controls, so we can measure things in detail. And as the particles and scalar propagate close to the in the vicinity of the intake, we can see that some particles are getting absorbed, and some of the dye is also being absorbed. So a flux is not an integrated quantity, so it's a little bit harder to interpret, but the particle count is basically a time integrated quantity, and so this gives you a good feel for what has been absorbed into the cooling water channel intake. So we have this recirculation region. Some of these particles are being entrained downstream, and of those particles, some of them are being absorbed into the intake. Okay, and we can quantitatively measure these numbers. Okay, so this is the kind of simulation. So I've isolated zone A for this example, but this is done for every zone in the map. And that's how we can start to build some metrics for what's going on. So we have particles released and traces released in zones A through K, and then for zone H, we did an additional depth sensitivity analysis. So run your simulations, plug in the fluxes and data and particle counts into your favorite spreadsheet. And here we go. We get the map we were looking for. So we end up with our percentages. So on the area A, B, C through L, and we have the percentage probability of absorption or entrainment of those particles into the intake structure. So what we can see is that, first of all, there's a great variability between where the particles originate from. Okay, so look at, for instance, areas on the lower embankment, C, D, F, J. All of those areas on the sort of lower embankments of the river are basically completely immune from entrainment. So that's already very interesting data. All of the ecosystem that is found on the lower bank of this river system here, by and large, is immune from any interactions with the intake. Conversely, what we see is that areas A and B, and E for that matter, are highly impacted, by the intake flow. Also, we see, interestingly, in region H, which is the one that we separated into three different depths, region H actually has a higher entrainment rate for those communities which are lower in the water column, below 10 meters or below 5 meters. And what is in the 0 to 5 meter range, which is area H, so this is the 0 to 5 meter range, as a 1% or almost 2% entrainment rate, whereas we have double that for the lower portions of the water column. Okay, so this made me wonder, well, what do we see at the if we cut across the intake structure, if we do a vertical slice, a 2D cut at the CWIS location, and let's look at what the traces that originated upstream in zone A, let's see what's happening to that tracer. And this video starts at the point where the tracer has meandered downstream and is just arriving at the level of where the intake is. So this is a sliced view across the river. This rectangular portion here is a slice of the intake, okay? And so what we see is that of that tracer that has been released upstream, a good chunk of that is getting absorbed into the intake, and we see some significant vertical structure, of course. Okay, so this you look at this, and then of course you want to see what's going on with the rest of the maps that we have. So let's see. Region A, we just saw, this is at a certain point in time. Region A has obviously lots of interactions with the intake structure, as does region B. Region C, almost zero. So that's what we had discovered earlier on. D, the same, and then E, which is here, also A, B, E. It's very obvious that these areas are affected by the water intake structure. Okay, F, not so much, I, not at all, and so on. So we can get a pretty good mapping, good feel for what's going on using these methods. Okay, so this has to make us think that depth considerations are indeed important. Clearly, there are substantial variations of concentration of traces in the vertical plane. So let's take a look. Zone H is the one we divided into three water columns. And I'm going to pause this. This is the particle release in the upper layers of the water column, 0 to 5 meters. Okay, so this is a bird's eye view, and you see there's some entrainment here, we think, and the flow here is being accelerated by the outlets of the thermal plume. Now this is the same, but we've zoomed in. So this is still the 0 to 5 meter depth detail, so we can see some pretty interesting conveyor belt action up here, these vortices here, and then different strands of the domain interacting differently with the structure. Oops, and I didn't mean to do that. So I'll play this again. So this is the initial bird's eye view. Then we have the detail. And then we will see the particle release from the intermediate water depth from 5 to 10 meters in. This is it. So this is the intermediary depth. And then what's left below that, below 10 meters, is going to show up in a second. There we go. These are the particles released in the very bottom of the water column. And in fact, what we can see here is that this zone here seems to be entirely in a recirculation mode at those lowest depths. So these particles, in fact, are not being affected, but the ones, there's a bit of a topography thing going on here, but the ones which were released around here, those are almost, those are severely affected by the structure. Okay, so if we take these 2D cuts that I mentioned earlier on and look at the absorption rates, on the top of the water column we have 1.85%, and you can see right here, this is a two, sort of three-dimensional but 2D slice of the water near the intake, and the darker red is the higher concentration. And so what happens, in fact, is that what's being released in zone H in the top of the water column drifts closer to the shore and, in fact, misses the absorption from the intake. However, the lower water columns, you see the red concentration is much closer to the absorbed to the inlet, and that is why we're seeing higher concentrations. So same thing, but with some additional data here, or rather plotted data, we see the sort of the whole thing happening at once. The different colors represent the different depths. Okay, so you have red at the top, 0 to 5 meters. Pink, 5 to 10 meters, and white. So I'll play this again so you can see what's going on. And this shows all three of them together. Okay, and you can see some of the particles being absorbed into the intake. Okay, this is actually the same slide, so I will skip this. It's the same data but presented a little bit differently. It's a pretty video. Okay, bottom line though, this is the bottom line. We want to know what goes where and to what extent, and these are the kinds of simulations and maps that give you that information. All right, so you know, we've identified zone A as problematic, high entrainment rates. Is there anything we can do about it? So one option we could investigate might be to judiciously place a floating barrier. Complete speculation. I'm starting with a blank slates, but the beauty of numerical simulations is that we can try things and see what happens. Adding this barrier, this is an obstacle that I added into the flow. It takes all of 10 minutes to modify the FLOW-3D setup, and we just then let the machine run and see what happens. So any second now, the fluid is going to arrive. You can see it in the top left corner. So you can see the interaction of the particles with this obstacle. And Well, doesn't look too good. In fact, it even looks like this obstacle might have made things worse. It looks like the circulation region is a bullseye basically onto the entry of the inlet structure. So visually, this does not look good, but who knows what the data actually says, and we will see this in a minute. We have our particle data count down here. Okay, so this did not look too good, so let's try a slightly different variation where we have a floating barrier which is diverting the flow a little bit differently and see if that does anything better for us. And now we can see the vertical structures behind the flow are very different. We can see that the scalar flux is also oscillating in a different way that we weren't seeing before. And we don't really know yet, but it looks like this might be a little bit more helpful than design option one, which we just saw. So the beauty of having high-end visualization tools, this is done in FLOW-Sight, which is FLOW-3D's next generation visual post-processor. The beauty is that you can compare things and actually get some data very quickly in your different case studies. So in this video, we have case one, which is the original zone A tracer release, particle release, which we saw first and we know has a high entrainment rate. Zone two, case two rather, we have this obstacle in front of the structure, and zone three, we have a slightly different obstacle. And let's see if we really do see any difference when we look at the hard numbers. So originally, not much difference, of course. But then after the flow steadies a little, we see some substantial differences. So the I'll pause this for a second. First of all, this one is a straight bullseye, basically, straight into the intake. The second option here is more convoluted, but it doesn't look like it's helping very much. This third one here is much more complex recirculation zones, but this may help, and so we will see shortly. And if you look at the particle count here on the intake, it's already looking better. The pink one is the alternate barrier diversion, the third one. The yellow is with no diversion, and the blue is with is option two here. Okay, so let's continue running this and see how things evolve with time. So far, so good. It looks like option case three is witnessing basically a much, much lower entrainment rate, something of the order of 50%, it looks like. Okay, so by the time we've let this run for a while, what we see is that of that original set of particles, the absorption is halved by 50% for option number two, rather case number three. Okay, so this is what we can see very quickly, I should say, using numerical modeling. It's really not much effort once you're set up. Okay, so setting up the problem, there's certainly some work in terms of getting the data and getting the bathymetry and so on. But once you're model is set up, running the parameter space of different design options is something that is readily done. So I haven't talked of thermal plumes very much yet. So buoyant flows are handled through a complete density evaluation and or advection. Density dependencies, for instance, on salinity or some scalar concentration or temperature and so on, are all readily defined. Initial stratifications are also simple to define because you define individual initial regions of water where you can specify temperature, density, scalar concentration, and so on. So as initial conditions, you can also pretty much do anything you want. And fluid sources also hold their own full set of properties. So this little video is from a different animation, different model, but it has a nice little inset here. You will see the shape and evolution with time of the thermal plume 100 meters downstream of the outlet being right here. Okay, so this is a simplified model with simplified topography. Let's see, you will see a thermal plume coming out here, and you will also see the cross section up here on the right. Now, let's see what we see. These are some particles that were released, but what's going on with the thermal plume is down here. Okay, so we see the thermal plume is basically constrained to the left side of the embankment, potentially because even though the topography is simplified, there is actually some elevation here which is constraining the flow to the left. Now if you look in here, you can see the extent of the plume, where the fluid is the hottest, coolest, and so on. Note, in this case, initially the signal is a bit noisy, but then we have the beginning of what in this simulation was a tidal signal. In fact, this continues as a tidal signal. Okay, so that's one example of how you visualize a thermal plume. And then actually getting back to the one of the first animations I showed you, just down here on the left is where you need to be looking at. This is the thermal plume exiting the outlet. Okay, so I'll pause that here. My conclusions, FLOW-3D is a powerful analysis and visualization tool. It's particularly well suited for HDI, hydraulic zones of influence mapping and thermal plume mapping. The computational power has evolved enough that we can now basically resolve a water region of several kilometers, in full three-dimensional detail, without, being too extravagant in terms of computational time. In the work I do, I almost never let a simulation run for more than, overnight or a day, maybe rarely 48 hours, but three-dimensional mapping, three-dimensional modeling has come far enough that we can do this for pretty substantial bodies of water. Now, for the larger scales, what we do is we integrate full 3D modeling where we care about the detail of the flow or the interaction of the flow with structures, and we nest those meshes into larger scale shallow water meshes where we resolve the shallow water equations. So that's a different topic, but for those dealing with environmental flows, be aware that it's seamless in FLOW-3D. It's an interesting tool. So stay tuned for January 14th, which is the release of the final ruling of EPA 316B of the Clean Water Act. The reason I scheduled this webinar for December 5th is because the EPA, the ruling was supposed to come out on November 4th, but it was delayed because of the furlough. So January 14th is the new release date, and with that, I would like to thank you and for attending, and any questions, please email me. I really enjoy hearing about what everyone is doing in the industry. I also enjoy exploring what can be done when you don't have a solution. If it's anything to do with hydraulics or water engineering, chances are Flow3D can be a good tool. Okay, thank you, and enjoy the rest of your day.